Kathleen Staten here with Ars Lyrica, and you are center stage with Elizabeth Blumenstock. Elizabeth, we're thrilled to have you both on center stage and, of course, on the main stage for our next program. Tell us a little bit about the music that we're going to be hearing.
Well, we're going to hear a wonderful concerto by the Chevalier de Saint-Georges, who is a fascinating historical character as well as a fascinating musical character. And I think he was also a fascinating dancing character and maybe a fencing character. He was quite a character. So you'll find out more about him, I am quite sure. And you will hear the wonderful Christina Day Martinson playing one of his concertos. Christina and I fell in love with each other about 12 years ago. I hope she doesn't mind my saying that. But we didn't see each other for a very long time. And in fact, we got to play together last January in Boston, where we first met. And so I am so thrilled that it hasn't been another 10 or 12 years before I got to see her again. I'm looking forward to it, both musically and personally, a lot. We're also doing a fantastic Haydn symphony about which I know relatively little because I haven't played it for 15 or 20 years, but there is no bad Haydn. So, this piece will be fantastic. There's just no getting around that. Sorry. And I'm playing a Mozart concerto. I was offered to play any one of them. I've played the fifth one, the Turkish so-called, a few times, and I love it. It's a very big. It's the biggest, the final of his five concertos, and the biggest. And I looked at that one. I thought, you know, why not get to do what I haven't done? Because I'm not so young anymore and I might not get a chance. So I thought I'll play the one I haven't played, which is the third one, a beautiful G major, K216. And I want to say something about Kirchhoff numbers in a second. It's, you know, we think of violin concertos as being a certain kind of thing, especially as they march through history and become things like the Brahms concerto, the Dvorak, or the Tchaikovsky, or any of these, you know, sort of monuments of the Romantic repertoire. And then you look back to the Baroque violin concerto and you see very straightforward to some degree, three movements, which that still happens, but usually a very fast first and last movement and some kind of beautiful slow movement. That's still kind of happening, but with Mozart, actually the last movements are really quirky. In fact, there's a lot of quirky things about this concerto. It's rather operatic. So much of Mozart's music is operatic. I mean, he's just an operatic soul. And you'll catch a little piece of recitative in the first movement, just a little moment where he just sort of does this little back and forth between the violin and everybody else in a kind of spoken manner. Just very odd, just out of nowhere. Right? And then there's just a beautiful, I mean, you can see the slow movement on an opera stage. It's a dreamy setting. The lovers are wandering. They haven't quite met yet. I don't know what this outcome is, but it's definitely a visual as well as an aural treat. And the last movement is just flat out quirky. It starts out like it's just going to be a really nice little rondo, just a really cheerful little rondo in 3-8 with a few little variations and coming back to the main theme the way rondos do. But all of a sudden it just cuts out, goes into the minor, into a much slower tempo, into just sort of a kind of a careful gavotte like andante. And it's very weird. It's like, it's unexpected. And it's kind of like, it's like somebody wandered into your party. You're having this good old party and this strange man in unusual clothes stepped in and everybody kind of went, whoa, what's that?
That's like the end of the Veracini, you know, the G minor one where it's the all unison. So strange and odd. And it was this brilliant overture and it ends in the strangest way.
Terrible minuet. It's that terrible minuet. It's just so brutal. It's like, oh, what was he thinking? That's a really, after all that frothy beauty before, all those triplets in the first moment. Yeah, I totally know what you mean. It's amazingly strange. It's like the caffeine wore off or something and he was mad or something went wrong and he kept composing when he shouldn't have or something like that. Anyway, so here's this weird moment and it's polite enough, but it's very strange. And then instead of just cutting back to the rondo again and being all happy again in G major, he does yet another tempo change into an allegretto, and it's much more cheerful, and it's got a little patch in it that sounds like a musette with a kind of a drone going on in there, and then he finally gets back to business. But he doesn't take his last movement seriously. They're not the kind of like race to the finish line that we kind of have come to expect, or a big bombastic thing. It's extremely lighthearted. It's just wonderful that way. And I love that. And I wanted to say that thing about Kirchhoff numbers before I forget. By the time Mozart hit 18, when he was 18, he started really regular production of music. He was incredibly consistent. He was in fact so consistent that if you take the Kirchhoff number, divide it by 25, and add 10, within a year, that's how old he was when he wrote that piece. Pretty incredible. I don't know what mathematical genius figured that out, but I just love it. I've checked it, you know, every time I play a piece of Mozart, I go and I say, okay, did that work this time? And basically it works. It's quite remarkable. So he was not, you know, it's kind of odd to think of this spontaneous genius, mercurial character, this person who could just, he basically practically learned to play the violin by watching. The number of things he did by what means we cannot tell. Such a genius. You don't square that easily with regular output. That seems more like the guy who gets up and says, okay, I'm gonna bang out my 40 pages today and starts typing, you know?
That's Bach, right?
Exactly, except that was also not mechanical, you know? I'm just in awe. I mean, I think it must have been that the music was just constantly pouring out and he just had to get at it. I like to think that anyway.
Well, and you've got the music constantly pouring out of you. You're actually talking with us today from where?
I'm in San Francisco right now in the so-called green room. I think it's white, actually off-white, at Herbst Theater. And we're about to play, Philharmonia is about to play a concert with Skip Sempe conducting, a program of 17th century, almost exclusively, pretty much, yeah, French and English repertoire.
Is it dizzying for you to go back and forth between so many different, I would call them voice types, the stylistic nature of bowing and interpretation and phrasing, not just from Baroque to classical, but also French Baroque to a totally different style of understanding the musicality?
You know, that's an interesting question. And I know that it can be an issue. Just like people who have perfect pitch, it's an issue sometimes playing at A415 or A430, or, you know, there's just these adjustments that you have to make. I have to say, though, that I haven't had trouble with this particular aspect of playing music, because this music appeals to me so much, because to me it is like speaking. Both the Baroque repertoire and the French to some degree, speaking in French, of course, and the classical repertoire as well. The idea that early music is rhetorical music is a very powerful and true thing, but it was not lost going into the classical period. Various tropes and memes and phrase structures absolutely survived through the classical era and well beyond, actually. And that whole kind of approach was just ingrained. It was just part of how music was written and performed. So on that level, shifting from, say, you know, Bach to Mozart isn't, you know, or even Purcell to Mozart, it's just not as wild a stretch on some fundamental level.
Well, and I think it's easy for us to forget, you know, it's ingrained in us that these people are shoehorned into a very specific style and time period, when in reality, of course, they existed on the shoulders of styles and were deeply embedded in the styles of their teachers.
Exactly. I mean, Leopold Mozart was no mean slouch, and he composed one of the famous violin treatises. And so he was talking about Baroque music. He wasn't talking about classical music just because his name was Mozart, right? So, Mozart grew up with that. That was his pedagogy, right? But he was also incredibly open and sensitive to all the other things that he heard around him. And he was born, 1756. So he was really very much at the tail end. He was born into the Rococo gallant, very gallant style, right? And he absorbed that and just ran with it.
Elizabeth, I'm looking so much forward to hearing you play in this style. I'm so familiar with your incredible musicality in the Baroque style. So this will be a treat for me and for all of our listeners. I don't know which I enjoy more, getting to hear you talk about music or getting to hear you play it. And so I deeply appreciate you taking the time to sit down with us today. And I know we're all looking forward to seeing you back on the stage at the Hobby Center.
Wonderful. You're very welcome, and I can't wait.
Thank you. We'll see you all soon.